this week's show, Tesla relaunches the Model S 60 and introduces the Tesla Model S 60D, the Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid gets hacked, and Google teaches its cars to honk their horns. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolved.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, June 10th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and the great Portland heatwave of last weekend seems to have finally abated. Phew! I can finally wear a hoodie again. Woo-hoo-hoo! As we were sitting down to get this week's show ready, I have to admit I was a little lost for a headline story to start the show with. But luckily, thanks to an unexpected announcement from Tesla on Thursday morning, we got one. What was the announcement, I hear you ask? A new high-end model, perhaps? More autopilot functionality? A price drop? No, no, and not quite. You see, Tesla announced on Thursday morning that it's reintroducing the Tesla Model S 60, a car it discontinued last year to lower the point of entry for Model S ownership. Priced from $66,000 before incentives or mandatory shipping and handling fees, the new Model S 60 and its sibling, the all-new Model S 60D, were reintroduced following criticism from Tesla fans that its entry-level models were just getting more and more expensive. What's worth noting, however, is that these two new cars aren't fitted with 60 kilowatt-hour lithium-ion battery packs. Instead, they're fitted with 75 kilowatt-hour battery packs and electronically limited to use just 60 kilowatt-hours of capacity. And that means if at some point you have $9,500 spare, you can unlock that extra range long after you buy the car. Okay, it's not quite Model 3 affordable, but it's certainly a smart move. Staying with luxury for a second, we're off to the upcoming Paris Motor Show this fall, where Mercedes-Benz is rumoured to be unveiling the first of a series of long-range electric cars that it hopes will gain it some market share back from the aforementioned Tesla Motors. According to British magazine Autocar, the luxury German marque is currently putting the finishing touches to an all-electric concept SUV that previews a production electric SUV that is due to enter the market in 2019. Details are sparse at the moment, but as we explained a few weeks ago on this show, Mercedes-Benz promised new electric cars, two sedans and two SUVs, will each be loosely based on existing Benz models but carry their own unique body panels and styling elements to set them apart from the rest of the family. It's likely that these new models will make use of a next-generation CCS quick charging system that rivals Tesla's supercharger in terms of speed and power, as well as an all-wheel drive system for improved performance and road holding. But for anything else, we're going to have to wait until late September and the Paris Motor Show to find out more. Our third story today is another one of those "we didn't see this coming" stories, but it's one which shows that in the automotive world, absolutely anything is possible. You see, while Fiat Chrysler CEO Sergio Marchionne, who is also the CEO of Ferrari, absolutely hates electric cars, it seems that not all of his colleagues share that opinion. That's because on Thursday this week, Faraday Futures, the enigmatic Chinese-backed automaker with plans to change the world forever, but which has yet to show us even a picture of the car it intends to bring to market, announced that former CEO of Ferrari North America, Marco Mattiacci, also former managing director and team principal of the Scuderia Ferrari Formula One racing team, would be joining the company as its global chief brand and commercial officer. While it's fairly common for executives from prestige and luxury marques to join the ranks of Tesla, Faraday Future, or other electric vehicle projects, this particular hire made us smile, given just how skeptical Mr. Marchionne really is about plug-in cars. Will the hiring of this former colleague change his mind? It's unlikely. But hey, anything can happen. Do you own a Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid? Do you use the annoying Wi-Fi connection from the car to interact with its onboard telematic system? Well, if so, you'll want to pay attention to this next story because it involves your car. That's because at the start of the week, we heard from Pentest Associates, a UK security firm, that it's discovered a weakness in the telematic system of the Mitsubishi Outlander plug-in hybrid, centered around the Wi-Fi connection used to connect your phone to your car. You see, unlike other plug-in cars which use data SIMs to communicate back to base, Mitsubishi's telematic system uses an ad hoc network between the car and phone over Wi-Fi, a connection that, with the right equipment and skill, you can easily hack. As demonstrated by Pentest Associates, the end result is that your Outlander plug-in hybrid electric vehicle could not only be easily broken into, but also stolen. And while we understand Mitsubishi is working to address the fault, the best solution right now is to unpair your car with your phone, instructions for which on how to do are over at our website at transportevolved.com. So if you're an Outlander plug-in hybrid owner, head over there at the end of this show to read up a little more on this particular exploit. Aside from Tesla Motors, which has its own proprietary charging network for its customers to use, the next biggest automaker to invest in electric vehicle charging infrastructure is Nissan, with a long and distinguished history of collaboration and sponsorship of charging networks all around the world. Well, this week, Nissan announced its involvement in a new EU-backed project called Fast-E, which is designed to improve the number and reliability of electric vehicle charging stations across Europe, working alongside eight other companies with a total investment of around 18 million euro between them. Nissan and its partners will help install a total of 241 multi-standard rapid charging stations across Germany and a further 37 multi-charging stations in Belgium by the end of the year. A similar project in the Czech Republic and Slovakia will expand charging provision in Central Europe at the same time, making it easier than ever before to own and operate an electric car. So well done to Nissan and its partner companies in pushing for more public charging. Talking of charging, the CHAdeMO Accosiation, the worldwide body responsible for developing and advocating for the CHAdeMO DC quick charging standard, announced at the end of last week that it was readying a new, more powerful 150 kilowatt DC quick charge standard for publication later this year, with the first 150 kilowatt capable stations to be installed early next. While CCS, the standard jointly developed between US and European automakers, is currently the preferred standard among car makers, CHAdeMO is still the dominant standard by volume, so it does kind of make sense to see the protocol get an upgrade ahead of the next generation 200 plus mile electric cars from the likes of Nissan, who prefer CHAdeMO. What's best is that the standard is also designed to be backward compatible, meaning that while those with current electric cars won't be able to charge any faster at 150 kilowatt stations, they will be able to make use of them, and vice versa. And looking further forward still, the CHAdeMO Association says it's studying an even higher powered variant capable of more than 350 kilowatts of instantaneous power. Now that's what I'm talking about. Now, it's a dream for many an electric vehicle advocate, a future where internal combustion engine vehicles are relegated to the history books. But as many in the industry will admit, it's going to take quite a long time before every car on the road is powered by some form of all-electric drivetrain, be it hydrogen fuel cell or battery electric. Or will it? Because this week, Norway, yes, the world's leading example on electric vehicle mass adoption, proposed a new legislation which, if passed, could ban the sale of all new internal combustion engine vehicles on the nation's roads by 2025. Yep, you heard it right. If passed, it could make it illegal to buy or sell a new petrol or diesel-powered car in Norway in just 9 years' time. As you might expect, the proposal has already gained a lot of support in the electric vehicle world, and Tesla CEO Elon Musk has already praised Norway's forward-thinking politicians for even suggesting such a thing, tweeting that Norway was an amazingly awesome country and that it totally rocked. We've got to agree with him, and he's hoping that this bill becomes law for the betterment of air quality around the world. It's hard to believe it, but it's now been more than 2 months since Tesla began taking deposits for its upcoming 2018 Tesla Model 3, and several weeks since Tesla published reserved pre-reservation figures suggesting that more than 380,000 people around the world had put down their name for the mass-market $35,000 long-range plug-in sedan. And as we discovered covering Tesla Day back at the end of March, there's a real cross-section of the community placing orders for Model 3. But this week we learned, courtesy of our friends at Electrek, just how many Tesla and SpaceX employees took advantage of the early reservation slots offered them by Tesla and put their names down on the waiting list before the general public. The figure, around 13,000 employees split between the two companies, isn't official, but it was calculated from the sequential reservation number codes hidden in each and every My Tesla page of Model 3 reservation holders. While Tesla has now patched that site to prevent those numbers from being shown, Electrek says that it's confident that its figures are in fact correct, since there are some missing 13,000 numbers between the first Australian reservations, the first place you could actually order a Model 3 and on 31st of March, and the number known to start the reservation queue. And while neither they or we could corroborate this story any further, it certainly goes to show that many of Musk's minions are well and truly chugging the Tesla Kool Aid. Good for them. Switching gears now, we're off to South Korean automaker Hyundai, which drip-fed some more information this week about its plans to expand its lineup to include a large number of electric and plug-in hybrid vehicles in the coming years. Of course, we already know about the upcoming Hyundai Ioniq and plans to build a new longer-range model by 2020. But this week, we heard from Hyundai Genesis brand boss Manfred Fitzgerald that Hyundai's prestige marque would be getting its own electric vehicle in the coming months. Like the rest of Hyundai, Fitzgerald said that the Genesis model brand would develop electric and other alternative propulsion cars, which we're reading as hydrogen, to offer alongside its more conventional models. But he also said that full electric cars will be the future of the auto industry, something we've not heard yet from a Hyundai executive. Will it compete with a Tesla Model S and other luxury plug-ins being planned from brands like BMW, Mercedes-Benz and Audi? You bet. But we'll have to wait a little longer to find out details on this Genesis plug-in. Sorry. And finally, love it or loathe it, the car horn is an essential tool on today's modern roads, regardless of whether you're using it for its original purpose, essentially warning other road users of your presence, or laying on it in anger because some mofo just cut you up at the lights. Of course, how you feel about the car horn also depends on where you live in the world, but this week we learned that after silently putting up with everyone's bad driving, Google's fleet of autonomous cars are about to start using their horns. But don't worry, this isn't robotic road rage. Google says that teaching its cars to honk at other road users is primarily so that its cars can warn distracted drivers of their presence, essentially warning those too engrossed in their iPhone or too lazy to use their mirrors that there's a highly trained robotic car that really doesn't want to be hit by them. Will it lead to the first altercation between a human and a robot? Probably. And I, for one, can't wait to see what happens next. What's happening next right here is that we're done for today. So don't forget to leave your reactions to the stories we covered in the comments below, as well as giving us a thumbs up and a share if you liked it. And if you didn't, give us a thumbs down and tell us why, because otherwise, well, we won't improve. I'll be back next week at the usual time with another episode of TEN, but in the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print on our website at transportevolve.com. You can catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by supporting our Patreon crowdfunding campaign from as little as $1 per month over at patreon.com/transportevolved. As we've said before, we really want to grow our network and our site, and the speed at which we can grow is directly proportional to how much money we bring in every month. So if you aren't already donating, please consider it. Every dollar really does help. As always, there are lots of stories you didn't manage to fit into today's show, including news of how 100 BMW i3 electric cars will be joining the LAPD, a Bank of America Merrill Lynch analyst goes bearish on Tesla, we ask if old electric and hybrid cars can be kept alive thanks to the maker culture and 3D printing, and we try to peel back hyperbole from both sides in the ongoing battle between Tesla and owners who, usually erroneously, claim their cars crashed themselves. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a fantastic weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.